Or, to take a different kind of example, a study by Amartya Sen of recent demographic patterns in Asia indicate that as many as 100 million women were missing in the region as a result of the discriminatory allocation of basic resources, as well as life-threatening cultural norms such as sun preference. Sen argued that these factors produce gender-specific abuses such as female infanticide, the systemic malnourishment of girl children, and dowry-related deaths. I want to make it clear that I think it's really women's equality and human rights that are at stake, both locally and globally, rather than some more contentious notion of feminism, which non-feminists and anti-feminists have been so quick to dismiss. And much turns on our understanding of equality itself, which has been characterized in a variety of different ways. If we look at the context of developing understandings of women's equality and women's rights within the United Nations and its agencies, say since International Women's Year in 1975, the question arises as to whether equality and non-discrimination should be thought of in purely public legal and political terms, as is usual in the West, or whether issues often thought of as more in the private sphere, such as women's poverty and exclusion from development planning, and issues of inequality and injustice in the home and in family relationships, should also be treated as relevant. Interestingly, much of the awareness of women's issues are well advanced globally. Sorry, were well advanced globally, even before some of the important recent Western equality movements had taken hold. But not, of course, before the suffrage movements of the 19th and early 20th centuries. In 1965, a UN Commission on the Status of Women addressed discrimination under the law and in political life, education, employment, marriage and the family, and traditional customs and practices. Such an expansive approach went beyond mainstream understandings of state-sponsored discrimination that prioritized legal equality. In an op-ed piece published last year, Naomi Wolf argued that the march of 300 Afghan women in Kabul in 2008 to protest the law that would permit marital rape, limit women's movements without male permission, and even make it illegal for a woman to refuse to dress as her husband wishes, was based on an opposition to the idea that women are merely the property of others. And Wolf believes this protest constituted a defining moment for non-Western feminists, which signaled the end of Western feminist leadership. She's particularly adamant that these reactions in Afghanistan and other countries are significantly different from what she interprets as the Western feminist demand for personal autonomy. Decision-making, she says, based primarily on a woman's own wishes rather than as a wife, mother, community member, or worshiper. Her contention is that the feminism in some more traditional societies is more profound and humane than our Western version. Family-centered rather than self-centered, and valuing service to community rather than personal gratification. According to Wolf, the opposition of women in more traditional societies is not to men but to violence and sexual assault, forced child marriage, bride burning, and legal exclusion from parity. But of course, the opposition of women in Western societies is also not to men. And feminists have been strongly focused on community and on the means to remedy obvious wrongs, such as violence against women and children, discrimination in employment, the consequences of systemic poverty, and resistance to equality. So I think that her particular take on the differences between Western and non-Western feminism is just wrong. Moreover, her mistake is a common one. Many critiques of a Western emphasis on individual rights seem to suggest that considerations of one's own needs and well-being are incompatible with thinking about the needs and well-being of others. In 2002, this foundation sponsored a symposium entitled Community Values in an Age of Globalization. Our keynote speaker, Benjamin Barber, spoke eloquently of the reality of an ineluctable interdependence, which required a resonating new declaration of interdependence to symbolize our entry into a period when democratizing globalization is not a dream of idealists, but a necessity for realists. Barber also spoke of recognizing a new global reality in which liberty can no longer be protected state by state by state, but can prosper only when we fashion a common community as broad as our common humanity. In a way, it's a version of the adage long espoused by civil liberties and human rights groups that none of our human rights and liberties can be protected unless those of all are protected. Also, there are fundamental ethical issues at stake that should not be missed in these discussions of equality. And since I'm a philosopher, or at least was, I don't think anybody would claim me anymore. One of my favorite starting points for this kind of discussion is with John Stuart Mill's The Subjection of Women, published in 1869. Mill's treatise is full of gems on the subject of women's equality, beginning with an expression of his long-held and ever-strengthening opinion, and I'm quoting now from him, that the principle which regulates the existing social relations between the two sexes, the legal subordination of one sex to the other, is wrong in itself, and now one of the chief hindrances to human improvement, and that it ought to be replaced by a principle of perfect equality, admitting no power or privilege on the one side, nor disability on the other. Mill, of course, expects questions to be raised about his view. What good, he asks, are we to expect from the changes proposed in our customs and institutions? Would mankind, interesting word, be at, but it was 1869, be at all better off if women were free? If not, why disturb their minds and attempt to make a social revolution in the name of an abstract right? And among his answers are two particularly interesting claims. First, he tells us, the changes would bring the advantage of having the most universal and pervading of all human relations regulated by justice instead of injustice. Furthermore, he says, the second benefit to be expected from giving to women the free use of their faculties by leaving them the free choice of their employments and opening to them the same field of occupation and the same prizes and encouragements as to other human beings would be that of doubling the mass of mental faculties available for the higher service of humanity. I used to find that just so wonderful. When I first read it, I thought, it's just so obvious. We're missing half. Both of these replies, I suggest, speak to the importance of recognizing that to continue to perpetrate inequalities of the kind we've been arguing against for at least 150 years is unjust and unethical. So besides all the practical and instrumental reasons for promoting genuinely equal treatment, there are deep ethical ones that are, in a way, even more fundamental. But more than that, it's hard to see how a full and robust expression of democracy can be realized without remedying the remaining problems of inequality and unfairness. And that may be part of what Charles Taylor was on about in that op-ed piece that Janet mentioned.